Okay, so we've already defined populations as the group of individuals part of a same species that lives in the same place at the same time. Whew, bit of a mouthful. I gave you a really quick example the first time around, the population of humans in Boston and the population of moose in the coniferous forest. I'm not gonna attempt to draw that. But right now I'm going to give you a more in-depth example. That involves a species of ant. So let's say you have a species of ant called the alpha ant, and it lives in two places. It lives in Massachusetts and New Jersey. So if you wanted to talk about the population of alpha ants in Massachusetts, you are only referring to the alpha ants in Massachusetts at this time. So if you were talking about the population of alpha ants in North America, however, you are referring to both the population of alpha ants in Massachusetts and New Jersey, because North America encompasses both Massachusetts and New Jersey. You could also break it down more specifically. Let's say you want to talk about the population of alpha ants in Harvard versus the population of alpha ants at MIT. These places are both in Massachusetts. In fact, Harvard and MIT are both in Cambridge, but if you were talking about the population of alpha ants at Harvard, it has nothing to do with the population of alpha ants at MIT. So you can see how the specificity of your location will change the size of your population, and the more specific you get, the more broken down the population becomes. So you can apply this to the population of humans as well. Let's say you have the population of humans in New York City. You could also have the population of humans in North America. And that would incorporate all the humans in New York City and all other cities and other places, all in North America. You could also have the population of humans of the world. And that would be all the humans that live on this earth at this moment. So world in 2011. So now that you have a more detailed definition of what populations are, why don't we go and examine the properties of populations. So there are three properties of populations that are size, density, and dispersion. Size is the number of individuals in a population, and that's determined by the number of births, the number of deaths, the amount of immigration, and the amount of emigration. So immigration is the individuals that enter a population, and emigration are the individuals that leave the population. Density is the number of individuals per unit area or volume, and the larger the population, the denser it becomes. So for example, the number of elephants per square mile, or the number of people per square mile. And if you think about it, clearly there are a lot more people in the cities than in the countryside, so it's less dense in the countryside than it would be in the city. Obviously, scientists can't go around counting all the individuals in a population to get exact numbers for population size and density, so they use different estimation techniques to estimate these numbers. For example, scientists will use the method of mark and recapture, and in this technique, they will capture different organisms in a population. So for example, if they're looking at the elephant population, they'll capture an elephant, and they will tag it, and then let it back into the environment. And after a few years, the scientists will come back and collect more elephants, and they examine and count how many of the elephants that were tagged the first time around are recaptured the second time around. And based on these numbers, they can use a mathematical formula to determine approximate numbers for the population size and density. So the last property of populations is dispersion, and there are three different patterns of dispersion shown here. The most common pattern of dispersion is clumped dispersion. And this occurs when individuals in a population are seen in groups. So you can see these elephants travel in groups. And clumped patterns usually are most often seen in animal populations, because animals travel in groups for protection in numbers. And you can think of a school of fish, a pack of wolves, a flock of geese, and all these animals are traveling in groups and show this clumped pattern. There's another pattern of dispersion is called the uniform pattern of dispersion, and this is when the individuals are very evenly spaced from each other. And this can happen in plants when plants secrete toxins into the soil around them to keep other plants away from them so that the other plants won't encroach on their space and on their nutrients. And another example of a population that would show uniform dispersion would be the penguin population, and this is caused by aggressive interactions between penguins in that population. So penguins will keep a fairly safe distance away from each other. The last pattern of dispersion is random dispersion, and that can be seen when there is no structure in the pattern. So it's generally caused by a lack of attractive forces and a lack of repulsive forces. And you see this often in well, all the time in dandelion populations, because dandelion seeds are dispersed by the wind. And the wind doesn't think, oh, let me put this seed here and this seed there and make it perfectly uniform. No, the wind kind of just blows it out into a field and goes, voila, modern art. So dandelions end up growing in really random patterns. So remember that all populations are defined by their size, their density, and their dispersion.